class at 6:30. I don't apparently don't like most of the hours of the time, 5 or whatever. And the next prime are congruent to A mod Q, we can predict asymptotic formulas for the following shape. With something a little bit uglier for non-diagonal patterns, that can sometimes simplify down if you combine, say, AD and DA. And again, kind of the key thing to observe here is that you have this relatively massive bias here, this log of the log, against these diagonal patterns relative to the non-diagonal. And so what we want to do now is kind of dig into this and explain where these sort of things are coming from.
So the first go at this is going to be very crude, and it's not really the right thing. And then eventually we'll try to say what needs to be done to make this a little bit more precise. But let's just start by looking at this pattern that A, the first prime is congruent to A mod Q, and the second prime is B mod Q. So what's that? I count primes, so 1 sub p is going to denote the indicator function for primes. So this is the prime n being a prime and congruent to a mod q. And then the next prime has to be some n plus h for some number h, which is going to be congruent to b minus a mod q. And h is positive because I want to count the next prime. Well, this is not exactly everything, because I also need to know that no composite number has appeared in between n and n. So that's this object here, where I count, I take the product over all the numbers t that intervene between 1 and h, for which maybe n plus t could have been a prime. And I put 1 minus the indicator function of primes here to say that this number must be composite. So how should we think about that? Well, the first two things we're going to eventually use Harley Little with, but for this idea that this number n plus t should be composite, it's tempting to first approximate it by saying the chance that a number is composite is roughly 1 minus 1 over log n. So that's kind of what we're going to do, replacing the probability that n plus t is prime by a 1 over log n. Well, of course, this is not exactly true. It's not true for many reasons. But in particular, one reason why it's not true is because we've already used the fact in this product that t plus a is co-prime to q. And since I'm conditioning on the fact that t plus a is co-prime to q, the probability the number is prime should be adjusted from 1 over log x to q over phi q times log x. This again is not true, but let's pretend that this is true as a starting point. Well, if that's true, then the product has roughly phi q over q times h terms in it. So this product should be roughly replaced by an exponential weighting function, which is this e to the minus h over log x. And this ties in with a lot of other stuff that we know. We expect the gaps between consecutive primes to be like the gaps of a Poisson process with parameter log x. And this e to the minus h over log x is reflecting that same phenomenon. OK, so if I interchange sums, now I want to understand with this weighting e to the minus h over log x, I now just have to understand when n and n plus h are both prime. And n is lies in a progression, and h lies in a progression. And for this, we can use the Hardy-Littlewood conductor. So the Hardy-Littlewood conductor tells me what happens if I just want n and n plus h to be prime. You have the singular series. I need to modify this a little bit to account for the various congruence conditions. So if I now insist that n is congruent to a mod q, and this is not just for any h, but in fact, we should insist that h plus a should also be co-prime to q, so that there will be primes of this, prime pairs of this form. And in that case, we have this modified singular series, just omitting the primes that divide q. Okay. So that's Robert will take over to explain how this proceeds.
Indeed. So essentially, at this point, what we want to do is we want to take the Hardy-Littlewood conductor, just naively plug it in here, and see what results. And we see the singular series appearing here. The question is, what should we do with that? Okay, this is some sort of complicated thing, but there's a result of Gallagher, a little bit stronger than this, but it shows that singular series like to be one on average. So at least kind of as a first approximation, one thing we can do is just replace a singular series by one. And if we do that, you know, being again very, very crude, what we arrive at is the following, which we can evaluate exactly or asymptotically. We see something of this shape. We essentially just pick up a factor of log x over q and canceling things out. This gives us 1 over b squared times x to log x, which is exactly what we believe the main term should be. So being crude at this level, we find the main term. And in fact, if we just are a little bit more intelligent than just blindly plugging in this result of Gallagher, and actually sort of understanding the sum of singular series, we can actually see the source of the anti-diagonal lines. And again, this is going to come about from the following proposition, which we quickly mentioned in the first talk this morning. And again, the idea here is we're summing the singular series over a residue constant b minus a mod q, and it happens that if you sum over the residue constant 0, and then you pick up this negative log-log term, while if you sum over residue constants non-zero, you don't. And so already, this is just completely enough to explain the anti-diagonal lines. Of course, there's something a little fishy here, and of course, there's something fishy with everything we've done so far in this talk. But one thing you can sort of immediately say that this can't totally be right is we have this log-log term that's kind of not canceled out by anything. You sort of average over all of the possible choices of b, we should get something without a log-log, because we understand primes and arithmetic progressions very well. So you have to worry about that. And the question is, how do you sort of do this more carefully, where you can see these things sort of canceling out? And also sort of picking up the lower order terms we really are there. And the key to all of this is really our first approximation, where we replace the characteristic function of the primes by its expectation. This is, of course, a really crude thing to do. And so the question is, what can we do to do this more intelligently? Well, one thing we could do is we could take this product, expand it out, invoke Hardy-Littlewood, start to analyze this, and try to figure out what's going on. If you do this carefully, you can eventually be led to the right place. But this is ugly. And moreover, you have some pretty big uniformity issues in terms of the range of coefficients, or the variables, and really through the number of variables you would want to apply the Hardy Littlewood difference in conjecture 4. So the question is, what can we do to avoid that? And the idea is that this approximation here actually got us most of the way. We got down to the right main term and the anti-diagonal bias, and so somehow if we can kind of incorporate this expectation into the Hardy-Littlewood conjecture, we might expect to get a better result. And so that's the idea. We want to incorporate inclusion and exclusion directly into the Hardy-Littlewood conjecture. And the way this is done is to modify the characteristic function of the primes by subtracting off its expectation. And if we do that, you can formulate the following conjecture. This is essentially, again, more or less justified along very similar lines as the standard Hardy-Littlewood conjecture. The idea is if you now have some tuple h, integers, you want all of them to be prime or checking their deviation from the expectation of their primality. What we predict is, again, you're going to have this Archimedean, or the Vogel factor q, times the Archimedean probability, now times this modified singular series, where this modified singular series is exactly what arises from an inclusion-exclusion type process. And so the question at this point becomes, now how do we understand the sums of these sort of modified inclusion-exclusion singular series?
So I want to say that so this one tool, this normalized indicator function that's written out here, we are thinking of n as being a number that's co-prime to q. So that's why this q over pq has already been taken into account. But this kind of a function appeared earlier in my work with Hugh Montgomery when we were looking at primes in short intervals. We were trying to compute moments of the number of primes in short intervals, and this led to a really kind of a nightmarish problem of trying to understand averages of singular series in many variables. And in that context, we were led to think more about this function, the normalized singular series, SQ0, we didn't have a Q, just S0, and we formulated an analog of this conjecture in that setting. So let me say, what is more, why is this S0 more friendly than the usual singular series has? So the usual singular series has averages out to 1 on average. So if you take the usual singular series in k variables, let's say, and then you sum over all the variables lying in a box, then the usual singular series will average out to give you h choose k plus smaller order terms. Just the number of ways in which you can choose a set with k elements from 1 to 8. However, if you try to understand the asymptotics of that sum over singular series, it's not very pleasant. You can get an h to the k, you can maybe get the h to the k minus 1 term, Q and I did that, and then you can't quite get the h to the k minus 2 term. The asymptotics just become a mess. And in fact, I think part of our work shows also that there will be a natural boundary of the asymptotics that you calculate, and you can't really get beyond h to the k minus 3 hat. However, what you and I noticed was that if you take this modified singular series S0, then we can actually go remarkably far in understanding its asymptotic properties. Basically, the left-hand side in this theorem has about h to the k terms because you're summing over subsets of size k from 1 to h. But the right-hand side, you see, gets square root cancellation in every variable. So in fact, we get an asymptotic formula. The mu k are the moments of a Gaussian distribution. So they are for even numbers, they're given by some double factorial, 2k minus 1 times 2k minus 3, and so on up to 1. And for the odd numbers, it just vanishes. And you can see that there are h to the k terms on the left-hand side, and the asymptotics only are of size h to the k over 2. So what does this mean? This means that when we expand out in this conjecture that Robert mentioned just now, if you expand out all the terms that you get in trying to use Hardy-Littlewood k to the conjecture, many, many of the terms are relevant, at least if you average over the variables, over all the variables. So in other words, if you write them just in the usual singular series, you would have to worry about the contribution of pairs, of triples, of quadruples, and so on, and each of them will make some contribution. But if you use inclusion-exclusion carefully and subtract out the main terms, and if you have this modified singular series, you don't have to worry about anything except for the sets with just two elements in it, anything with more than three elements in it, contributes to lower order of magnitude, and we can dispense with it. So at this point, Doron Zeilberger asked about the rigor of making this argument rigorous. So at this point is something that we take as a guide from my previous work with Hume Montgomery. But we think that the same thing will happen if you also impose congruence conditions on the elements that you choose from the set, the elements in the singular series. Now, I should also say that this theorem that Hume and I proved builds on the work of Montgomery and Vaughan on reduced residues, which is one of the key ingredients in making this argument. All right. So coming back to that heuristic, if you look at the conjecture that arises out of Hardy-Littlewood, there are three flavors of two-term singular series that we have to worry about. So remember that there was this variable t which goes up to h, goes from 1 to h, and these were the possible numbers between n and n plus h for which n plus t could have been a prime. So there are three kinds of terms that we have to handle. One is nothing from that product, just taking a term one. So this is just a singular series, m and n plus h being prime. This contributes to the main term. It has a bias against the diagonal, which we saw earlier. But then there are two other things that could happen. You could take an interloper t, and you could either form the singular series of coming from n and n plus t, making both of those be prime. So that would be the set 0 and t. Or you could have a situation where you have an interloper from t, and you want n plus t and n plus h to be prime, and everything else is kept constant. So there are two kinds of sets that you get out of here, 0t and th. These come with a negative sign. So there's a bias that comes out of these, but there's a negative bias always that comes out of it when t happens to be a multiple of q, for example. However, because of inclusion-exclusion, these terms all come with a negative sign, and the negative and the negative gives you a positive sign, and that's the bias that's a positive bias for all the residue classes which are not, where h is not 0 mod q. And then finally, you can have two terms, t1 and t2, where you have to understand whether n plus t1 and n plus t2 are prime. This again, this is the same no matter what h was, so it doesn't depend upon h at all. So this is some constant bias that happens for all possible residue classes, which again we can understand. And putting all of these together, we arrived at our main heuristic. What it also says is that if you look at the contributions from three-term singular series and so on, you would have to use modifications of my work with you, and those would give further lower order terms, maybe of size log squared over log squared would be the first set of bias. And then there'll be some other terms involving maybe a log cubed and a log over log cubed and so on. But these are secondary biases, which are however washed out by what happens with the two-term singular series, where we had an error term which was of size, I think log to the minus 7/4. That is some crazy thing coming out of zeros, and that's going to be there all the time, and it doesn't get washed out, it's not a persistent bias, so it will wash out equally often. It might be positive, equally often it might be negative, we think. This is way beyond anything that's reasonable to conjecture. And then there will still be these lower order terms muddying the waters a little bit more. I think that's about all we have to say, and here's the conjecture again. And all these biases have been coming up come from these two-term singular series.
So I guess just to have a couple of minutes, maybe what I'll do is just add a little bit of comment on what other contexts in which we might expect to see such a similar bias. And in particular, you might ask about, say, primes governed by some sort of Chebyshev condition in some Galois extension of Q. And there, I think sort of the basic test to be applying here is this. So suppose I tell you that p and p plus 2 are both prime. And I give you a little bit of information about p. Can you translate that into information about p plus 2? So for example, if I tell you the residue class of p, then of course you can tell me the residue class of p plus 2.
But if I could tell you that, say, p splits completely in some Galois extension, which doesn't admit any abelian quotients, you can't tell me anything about what p plus q does. It's independent. And I think that independence is exactly what you need to say, that there's no bias here. I think maybe let's...
So all the biases that we have found have been in abelian situations.
Yeah.
There have been all the non-abelian biases that we have found.
Right.
There will also be biases in things like square-free numbers. But again, those are somehow less interesting in the sense that those are explained by the fact that if a number is square-free, then of course there are many other numbers that get a chance to be square-free before you cycle back to that. So for example, if you take a large modulus like 101, we're not really going to see in nature a gap of 101 between two consecutive square-free numbers. I mean, of course we can construct them, but they're going to be positively generalized. So somehow this feature of the biases in primes, it turned out to be the beginning, especially in large bias. We're quite happy that it worked out that way. But in other situations, maybe that's not such a similar large bias.
Question? Comment?
So you commented on the simplification of what some of these constants say if you add together the cases A, B, and B, A. What if you took some other combination, like you summed up 1, 1, 2, 2, all A, A's, which would be something like the question of the probability that you pick a random prime and the next prime is the same as a mod Q. Is that anything?
So for A, A, I think we have a relatively nice formula already.
Yeah, first slide.
And then, yeah. So sorry about this. You're probably going to get dizzy.
Here we go.
Right. So that's, you know, that's not so bad. So that just averages out. How many actual constants are possible? We are still trying to figure out everything about C2. I don't think we understand it fully.
So. I mean, I guess to build on that, I mean, as far as the how many constants are possible, for generic moduli, if say if Q is prime, then this constant C2 almost determines the pattern AB. So it turns out there's a little bit of symmetry here between AB and minus B minus A. Those are sort of forced to be the same by the combinatorics. But apart from that, if you're looking at some modulus Q being prime or maybe square free or something like that, then this constant C2 will determine the pattern AB.
So you can also, you know, think of an analog of these sums of these constants for characters. So they are built out of some, you know, there's some object that you can define for every Dirichlet character. It turns out only odd characters are relevant. And then once you understand that set of those set of numbers, you can then recover all these numbers. So maybe that's a, you know, so there's like phi of q minus 1/2 actual numbers that you have to understand, and then from those you can understand these numbers in some relatively straightforward way.
Other questions or comments? Well, then let's thank all the speakers and the answers.